So now is the time to talk about the quality assurance of treatment planning systems. And I would like to thank Dr. Walid Al-Najjar for borrowing me some of his slides that I used in this presentation. We'll start by defining the treatment planning systems, then we'll just briefly review the dose calculation algorithms, and then we'll describe the quality assurance management of treatment planning systems as recommended by two important organizations like the International Atomic Energy Agency and the American Association of Physicists in Medicine. Nowadays, the treatment planning systems are computerized systems, and in external beam radiotherapy, they're used for the simulation systems, and in external beam radiotherapy, they're used for the simulation of the beam delivery setup and optimization and prediction of the dose distribution inside of the patient body. Software of a TPS includes not only components for the PC operating system, but also utilities to enter treatment units and associated dose data, to handle the patient data files and to enable structures contouring, image registration, dose calculation, plan evaluation, and archiving. Important component of any treatment planning system are the dose calculation algorithms. You probably know that those could be correction-based, model-based, or Monte Carlo. The correction-based calculation algorithms are using directly measured beam data and separating the radiation dose into primary and scatter components. Their main weakness is their accuracy. Because they assume electronic equilibrium, they're inaccurate near heterogeneities. They're also poorly modeling the scatter dose component and may not accurately reproduce beams for which measurements have not been acquired. And we're seeing in this picture the historical algorithm and their relative accuracy. Until 1970s, because no CT data were available, those algorithms were all correction-based. As the imaging and the computer technology evolved, new algorithms have been developed, starting with pencil beam convolution through collapse cone convolution and later on Monte Carlo or linear Boltzmann transport equations. Along with their development, their accuracy in predicting the dose has increased. The model-based calculation algorithms are using physical first principles to model the LINAC and the dose in the patient. Their main advantage is the improved accuracy of dose calculation for heterogeneous materials. They're more flexible in reproducing beam configurations for which measurements have not been acquired. They still have some limitation due to the assumptions they're making, and their commissioning might be a complex process. Currently, all treatment planning systems are using model-based calculation algorithms. And finally, we have the Monte Carlo methods that are using probability distributions to simulate the individual interactions of electrons and photons and their transport through matter. The dose calculation results are obtained by following the histories of a large number of particles as they emerge from the source of radiation and undergo multiple interactions inside and outside the patient. The idea of using Monte Carlo in radiotherapy planning is not a new one. It started almost 30 years ago. You'll find multiple articles assessing and comparing the performance of those calculation algorithms like this one or this one. Those studies show that for the same clinical condition, different algorithms will provide a different prediction of the dose. Therefore, we need some criteria to assess our algorithms. An important criteria will be their capability to accurately model all beam configurations using the clinic.
Also, it's important that they will accurately model the patient with respect to the external surface anatomy and the heterogeneous internal anatomy. It would be very nice if they would be easy to be commissioned and if the accuracy of the dose calculation doesn't come on the expense of the speed. The imaging radiation and radiation oncology core reviewed the algorithm available in the current treatment planning systems and categorized them as acceptable and unacceptable. However, not only the algorithm itself has to be accurate, the way we're configuring this algorithm has to be accurate as well. And this is a report from IROC showing the results of IMRT audits that have been done in more than 700 institutions over 10 years. The study showed that about 80% of the irradiation passed the very generous criteria of 7% deviation between the calculated and the measured dose, and only 69 of them met the criteria of 5%. And those are the results of the study, and as you could see, Pinnacle and XIO had the lowest passing rate, regardless the LINAC that was associated with them. Multiple reasons for failure were identified, among them the inaccurate input into the treatment planning system of output factors and PDDs, along with inadequacies in BIM modeling. This study, like many others, emphasizing the importance and the need for a quality assurance program for treatment planning systems. Generally speaking, the quality assurance management is an institutional process and responsibility, and in a radiotherapy department is overseen by a QA committee involving professionals of various specialties. The medical physicist, however, is responsible for the overall supervision of the use of the treatment planning system. There are several references discussing the quality assurance of treatment planning systems from IAEA, from APM, from ISTRO. There are also some national standards. I believe the most commonly used are the ones from IAEA and from APM, and those will be reviewed in this presentation. From IAEA, we have those two references, the TRS 430 and the TECDOC 1583. In order to proceed to commission your treatment planning system, you must have some equipment. You must have a water phantom scanning system to be used for data measurements, along with various detectors such as cylindrical ionization chambers, diodes, or parallel plate chambers. An in vivo dosimetry system would be useful, although it's not mandatory. You need also to have some other phantoms, like a CT phantom with materials with known relative electron density, a water equivalent slab phantom. An anthropomorphic phantom would be useful for the commissioning of typical or special treatment techniques. There is a large variety of equipment that you can find produced by different vendors. Each phantom has advantages and disadvantages for specific tests, and IAEA recommends that only phantoms with an anthropomorphic geometry and removable plugs with certified electron densities to be used when commissioning a treatment planning system. Although they don't endorse the product, they recommend this thorax phantom called CIRS. The phantom has a curved surface mimicking the shape of the human body and has also materials with densities close to the soft tissue, the lungs and the bones. What you have to do is to CT scan your phantom and then to import the CT images into your treatment planning system. And then so there are some clinical tests to be performed. Some of those tests are non-dosimetric tests, and they're meant to verify that your administrative data, the anatomical information or patient orientation have been correctly transferred from your CT scanner to your TPS. You need also to verify the way your TPS is converting the CT numbers to relative electron density. This is done by using the density reference values for various inserts of the phantom that you'll find in the manual. Another non-dosimetric test is to check the way your TPS is dealing with scaling. The phantom itself and the inserts inside have specific dimensions, and those are to be measured in your TPS and compared to the reference values provided by the manufacturer. Then there are 8 dosimetric tests to be done, and those tests are meant to be end-to-end tests. That means, using the CT images of your phantom, you have to create 8 plans with different beam configuration to calculate the dose in each of those plans, to report the dose in specific points, and then to take the phantom to your linear accelerator and to measure the dose in those points. Then you have to assess the deviation between the calculated and the measured dose. For each plan and for each point of measurement, tolerances are specified. You have to be careful to apply this formula correctly, otherwise you might not meet those tolerances. Those dosimetric tests are meant to check the performance of your TPS for different clinical scenarios, like reference conditions, oblique incidence, lack of scattering and tangential fields, significant blocking of fields corners, four field box, automatic expansion and customized blocking, oblique incidence with irregular field and blocking the center of the field, three fields with two edge paired and asymmetric collimation, and finally, non-coplanar beams with couch and collimator rotation. The report provides a detailed description for each of these of those plans and the beam configuration. It's important to know that you have to do those tests for each algorithm you might have in your treatment planning system. IEA also mentioned in this document that you should do some verification for IMRT plans. However, doesn't provide any recommendation on how those verification to be done. It's also not specifying any tolerance for this type of testing. Once your treatment planning system started to be used clinical, it has to be enrolled in a quality assurance program. This program must be structured in such a way that the risk of a serious error in patient dose is minimized, but should not be so elaborate that will impose unrealistic commitment on resources and time. The QA program must include periodic checks of the integrity of hardware, software, and data transfer, but also checks to be done after software upgrades, after changes of peripheral devices or methods of data transfer and modification of beam data. It's important to know that in the view of IAEA, training of the staff is part of the QA program. NTRS 430 provides a detailed description of the QA procedure to be performed. It recommends frequency for each of them. So this was what IAEA recommends. From APM, we have the Medical Physics Practice Guideline 5A. On the commissioning and QA of treatment planning dose calculations for megavoltage photon and electron beams. Here, the TPS commissioning and QA is seen as a three-phase process, the phases being data acquisition and processing, beam modeling and TPS validation, and establishing routine QA. This guideline is not applicable to systems that do not use an MLC for beam shaping, or to the small fields TPS, or to the non-commercial TPS, or to the secondary MU verification software. It's also not applicable to brachytherapy or to the non-dosimetric components like biological response models, DVH, image registration, or contouring. And here is the workflow to be followed for TPS commissioning and QA. First phase of commissioning is data acquisition and processing. And during this phase, physical measurements are to be made and analyzed for their use in the TPS. Attention to detail here is critical, as errors at this stage can lead to significant systematic error and potential consequences for patients under treatment. Some of the data we need to acquire and process are the city calibration data. That means the city to ED calibration curve. The recommended equipment is a city density phantom with materials with known physical and number within each density plug, and then within the TPS to create a table or a curve correlating the city number to the electron density. It is recommended to have a city-to-ED calibration curve for each city scanner you have in the department. Another type of data to be acquired and processed are the treatment beam data. Those are the data required for BIM modeling, and they must be collected according to the vendor specification. The report presents the detector suitable for BIM data collection, and describes the specific use of each one of them. Is also listing the equipment required for TPS commissioning and makes recommendation on the appropriate use of those pieces of equipment. If you look on the list, you'll see that the equipment recommended here is similar to the one recommended by IAEA. You must have a 3D water scanning phantom, a water equivalent slab phantom, a city density phantom, a heterogeneity phantom to be used for end-to-end testing. Very important, this time we have recommendation about the equipment to be used for IMRT or VMAT commissioning. Talking about the IMRT and the VMAT data, you need to know that the most treatment planning systems extrapolate basic beam measurements to produce their small field dose distributions. Therefore, small field or IMRT and VMAT measurements are not for the purpose of modeling, but for the purpose of model validation. We'll need to verify PDDs and output factors for small fields down to at least 2 by 2 centimeters. And also the MLC intra-leaf and inter-leaf transmission and the leaf gap. All data must be reviewed. They must be reviewed before their entry into the TPS by graphical display and analysis or by comparison to a reference data set. This reference data set could be golden data provided by the vendor, data from the literature or from a similar treatment machine you might have in the department. After their entry into the TPS, the data must be reviewed again by graphical display and spot checking. The BIM modeling and TPS validation is the second phase of commissioning. During this phase, the physical measurements are applied to the TPS software to produce a model according to the TPS vendor's instruction. The modeling is an iterative process with parameters being adjusted to optimally agree with the data used for comparison. Once created, the model has to be tested against additional physical measurements in a variety of simulated real use cases. The results of this testing are used to iteratively refine the model. The accurate model verification is affected by limitations of the model itself or of the measurements. The tolerance values and evaluation criteria should be clear and simple. If they're too tight, they might be unachievable, but if they're too loose, they might lead to suboptimal models, especially for IMRT and VMAT. For validation, each configured beam is distinguished by a unique energy and treatment head configuration. And there are 4 categories of calculation to be validated through this iterative process. First category refers to the basic dose algorithm validation for photon beams. Here, the calculation is to be done in a simulated water phantom in the planning module of the treatment planning system. Open plan fields, similar to measure fields used for modeling, are to be calculated and the dose in several points to be verified. The tolerance for this test is very tight. For instance, for the reference calibration condition check, the deviation between the calculated and the measured dose should not exceed 0.5%. In the same category falls the verification of the MLC-shaped plant fields, which are different from the measured fields used for modeling. The guideline describes how those MLC-shaped plant fields to be configured and provides tolerance for each one of them. And you could see that as we're shifting away from the relative conditions, the tolerance is increasing. A second category of calculation refers to the heterogeneity correction validation. Here, the calculation and the measurements are to be done not in water, but in a CT scan density phantom. Again, the dose at several points has to be verified, and the tolerance here is 3%. Oh. The third category is the IMRT and the VMAT dose validation. Here we have to verify small MLC-shaped fields not explicitly used in beam modeling and to perform end-to-end tests for IMRT and VMAT plants. The report describes on how those tests to be performed and recommends suitable detectors for each one of them. The tolerance for those tests for an end-to-end verification is 5% of the prescribed dose. However, for gamma analysis, a tight criteria of 2% to millimeter is recommended. This tight criteria can lead to the discovery of easily correctable problems in IMRT commissioning. Finally, the last category is the electron beams validation. Electron beams have to be calculated and measured in homogeneous and heterogeneous media in standard and non-standard condition. The last phase of this process is to establish routine QA procedures to be performed annually and after TPS upgrades. One of the reasons is to ensure that the TPS has not been intentionally modified, and this is done by the checksum files that are used to assure no changes to software configuration occurred. Some of the treatment planning systems are very smart. Even if you don't verify the checksum file, they will warn you if the B model has been changed. They're also keeping logs of the changes that have been done to the B models. Another reason for routine QA is to verify that the TPS continues to correctly calculate the dose after upgrade. And this is done through a comparison of calculated dose after commissioning against the calculated dose after upgrade. The tolerance for all routine QA recalculation is 1% 1 millimeter. It's important to know that the routine QA just complements but doesn't replace the machine QA. Measurements are not required for TPS QA. Instead, reference plans should be selected at the time of commissioning and then recalculated for routine QA comparison. Additional checks as DVH calculation, effective depth calculation, and CT number consistency can be performed using the same data set. It's important to know that AEPM highly recommends the peer review of the TPS model parameters, agreement to measure data, and validation procedure or results. This should include independent dose calculations of basic dosimetry parameter done by another physicist, compared with independent measurements also done by another physicist. Now, currently, any treatment planning system is capable to do IMRT and VMAT planning. Commissioning of those techniques are not covered in this lecture. However, it would be nice to know that we have some reports from AEPM, like this one on IMRT commissioning, or this one on IMRT measurement-based verification QA, or on calculation-based verification. On Wednesday evening, we'll have a workshop on measurement-based IMRT QA, and we strongly recommend you attend this workshop because we believe there will be a lot to be learned from it. So I'm done, or I still have time.
I think, go ahead.
Okay. So to summarize, the treatment planning systems are essential components of external beam radiotherapy. The accuracy of the dose calculation is paramount for safe and efficacious treatment delivery. A qualified medical physicist is responsible for the commissioning and quality assurance of treatment planning systems, and guidelines are available. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Camilia, for this.